Hi, I'm Anime Vigraj, and this video looks at anime history of the decade, show by show. It's a short list. This video looks at the whole of the centuries, probably thousands of anime in just over 30 seconds, so I may have skipped a few anime, but I tried to keep all the important ones in. So sit back and enjoy, and we'll get going through each decade in turn. We don't know when exactly or even who made this little loop, which is the earliest bit of animation in Japan. It was 50 frames stenciled right onto celluloid and made for friends or a private audience, and features a kid writing Katsudou Shashin or moving pictures in Japanese Kanji. Moving on from that period to 1917, Shimokowa Outen made the first Japanese film. He pioneered a whole bunch of cost-cutting techniques to make animation, which really helped the industry, as celluloid was really expensive at this time. Imokowa Mukuzo Genkanban no Maki, or the story of the concierge Imokowa Mukuzo, was his first film, but it doesn't survive to this date. Moving on from Outen, we have Jun’ichi Kouchi, who made Namakura Gatana, or The Dull Sword. This is a short anime produced by Kouchi. It was released in 1917 and just after Outen's Imokowa Mukuzo Genkanban, and follows the slapstick consequences of a samurai foolishly buying a dull sword. After him, we have Seitaro Kitayama, whose masterpiece would be Urushima Taro. Urushima Taro follows the story of the fisher lad Urushima Taro, a folk tale that gets airing in future anime, for example Gintama's 2008 Ryugyo arc. In this folk tale, a fisher boy saves a turtle who is being bullied by cruel children, and as a reward is taken to the palace of the dragon king of the sea. The folk tale is available here. Kitayama, Kouchi, and Outen are often thought of as the fathers of anime, and are the main players in the anime's first generation. Moving on from this period, we have the 20s and 30s, which is pretty much a lost period to anime. It bears the stamp of a ruthless price war with international giants, who were undercutting prices because they could afford to. Japanese animation was forced to use cheap cutout animation because cell was just too expensive. This resulted in stilted and flat animation, though there were some geniuses in its use up until the mid-30s. There were still some big budget works produced at this time which are now lost though. Famously, the first talkie anime, Shikara to Onna no Yo no Naka, Within the World of Power and Women by Kenzo Masaoka. Yasuji Murata, Noburo Ofuji, Kenzo Masaoka, and Mitsuyo Seo in particular were known for their genius with the cheaper cutout animation process. Moving on from that period, the late 30s was a hard time for animation, and companies had to do educational, business, or propaganda films for the most part. There was strict censorship, but the Ministry of Education liked documentaries. Studios that made documentaries started getting cash, and there was a big merger rush in which animation companies started getting absorbed. Suddenly, all the technical expertise and funding was centralized into large live-action studios, and ambitious animes could start being made again. Moving on to the 40s. An example of this time is Kumoto Churiku, or Spider and Tulip by Kenzo Masaoka, at one of these early studio giants, the Soshiku Studio. It's the story of a spider chasing a ladybird, but ends well for the ladybird. This is a film that does both pretty and menacing well. Par for the course for all animated classics. World War II propaganda tended to show the cunning and quick-witted Japanese winning out against enemies. Momotaro no Umiwashi, or Momotaro Sea Eagles, in 1945, by Mitsuyo Seo. This film is 37 minutes long. As can be seen, this show is totally serious about being a movie for adults. You can sort of see where Japanese anime gets its movie-like approach to cinematography. Moving on from that, Seo went on to make the sequel, which was Japan's first full-length feature film, Momotaro Umi no Shinpei, in 1945. Both shows seem to have a real liveliness to them. This